Damn, do I hate Google Drive and its cheap-ass 15 gigs limit. Ain't no way I'm paying for that. Damn, I swear if I catch a glimpse of the CEO, he's catching these hands. Damn! Oh, hi. Didn't see you there. What? Did you just hear silly little me having a calm and reasonable introspective monologue? Oh, you're in the same boat. Oh, you silly goose. Well then, I know just the right solution for you and me both. Come on, don't worry. Just trust me, we're almost there. There we go. Quite the beauty, isn't she? Okay, so I generally try to set a time limit on myself when taking on projects, so I don't abandon them halfway through. But this time I realized I probably should take my time as I figured I had no idea what I was getting myself into. But so I didn't jump in blind and also don't force you to piece bits and pieces together, I thought I should probably start with a plan, or at least a rough sketch. My ideology is always aim for the cheapest option. And that cheap option better be free, otherwise I'm not doing it. And so, I decided I had to do it all by myself. No paid APIs or software. Interaction with YouTube will be done using an UI automation framework, in this case Selenium. This means I have to study the flows of the app and then write automated tasks for them. With these flows, I need to be able to upload, download, query, edit, and delete videos. These functionalities must then be translated into easy-to-use commands the user can use to act at will in their remote storage system, which also means there needs to be a storage management system. Finally, because I'm not just doing a fancy repo over managing YouTube videos, I have to build an encoder and decoder that will allow me to select any file for upload and download in a seamless manner. Okay, now that we have a general outline done, let's get it going. I began by creating the web driver using the widely utilized Selenium Python. My initial intent was to fully automate it, having the user simply input their Google credentials into the console. Yeah, that turned out as you'd expect. After trying to automate a Google sign-in flow for a while, I had the inspiration to check if, perchance, it was disallowed by the Google overlords themselves. And yep, as expected. With option A out of the way, I went and tried to make it so a user could create a profile, log into YouTube with that, and then the app will detect the local profile and use it when starting the web driver. And lo and behold, it worked. After 3 hours, because for some reason the driver would crash if you already had a browser instance open and tried to use a profile in your automated driver. Something that drove me mad until I came across someone pointing it out after having dug through countless threads and forums, because surely it only affects a small percentage of the population. But after that was done, I could continue by implementing the main flows in navigating the YouTube website, which wasn't all that difficult nor interesting. Just that it took a while. All of this being attributed to a YouTube session controller. Now, to get back into the good stuff, I started designing the file tree architecture and its manager. For that, I wanted to look into how the big guys do it in cloud storage, and apparently they kinda squash the tree with folders not actually existing as well as their structure. Instead, they just associate the full path to the object and then recreate the representation as requested by the client. So, trusting the judgment of my forefathers, I implemented this approach. Storing the file's name as the video title and the absolute path starting from a predefined root as the description. This is the file tree session controller, offering functionality for navigating to a relative path, absolute path, or creating a directory and some other miscellaneous stuff. After tying these controllers together using a service locator and some callbacks, I could mimic issuing upload and download commands. But now I had to actually develop these commands, and because I can't possibly go the easy route, I decided to create a language parser with the help of Antler to fluidify the creation of new commands as well as validating, parsing, and extracting the appropriate parameters from them. And by defining a grammar, adding its rules, and compiling it, we have a language for our commands. To use this language and to obtain a crucial piece of the puzzle, I created a CLI session controller running in a separate thread, through which the user issues commands, which are in turn processed and their results printed to the console. By parsing each command through the defined language, I could identify its type and arguments passed to the main thread using a queue of callbacks, finally tying it all together. Now, to present the incredibly extensive list of commands. ls lists the files and directories in the current directory, which is always displayed in the current line in the console, just like in any other terminal. It's achieved by filtering the existing videos by description and either extracting the title or the next division of the path accordingly. CD attempts to navigate to a remote path, which can be absolute or relative, by filtering videos to check if any items exist in the desired CD path. And if negative, command won't be issued. mkdir, which creates a directory by appending it to the current path, but it's only temporary. If you navigate back and leave it empty without uploading a file to it, it's going to be discarded. mv, which moves a remote file from a location to another, which can be either absolute or relative, by simply editing the description of the associated video. rm, which removes the file at the specified absolute or relative path by simply deleting the video, then verifies if the current folder has any items left, otherwise navigates back recursively until one is found. Upload, which, by specifying a local path using the L colon specifier and a remote path using R colon, which can be absolute or relative, will upload the video. Now, there are two stages to this one. First, I went the obvious route of trying to open the upload file model, followed by automating inputting a path and submitting it, which turned out to be clunky and buggy, so I dropped it after discovering the existence of a hidden file input HTML element in the webpage, with which I communicated instead, skipping having to open the entire dialog. And finally, download, which, by specifying a local and remote path with the same specifiers, downloads the video using PyTube. Yeah, I kinda got lazy with this one. And finally, it was time for the main attraction of the project, allowing the storage of any type of file. For this, I set some targets as to optimize these expensive operations. Firstly, I could only create one temporary local file, the video to either be uploaded after encoding or downloaded before decoding. This meant frames had to be created in memory and sent out to the output file ASAP. I also didn't want the files to end up too big, as that would slow down the active part of the project too much. Also, data integrity was a must. I didn't want to have a non-zero chance of the remote data being altered or lost. I went through multiple iterations and solutions, with two particularly standing out. The first one was pretty much trying to brute force and cheat the system. I figured I would read the binary data of the original file in blocks of 6,220,796 bytes, or 6.22 megabytes. Extremely specific, you may think. Well, it indeed is extremely specific, as that's exactly what you get when you try to fill every byte of information in a 1920 by 1080 frame, in which each pixel amounts to 3 bytes, then subtracting 4 bytes, as those will store the total amount of data bytes in the frame. Thus, when reading or decoding the information in that frame, I'd read the first 4 bytes and then read that amount of bytes to append to the decoded data. Next, I considered the bitrate, which represents the amount of information, bits, a video has per second. So, in order to not lose any data due to going over that set rate, I had to set it at 6,220,796, the number of bytes per frame, times 8, the number of bits in a byte, times 24, as that's the frame rate I chose for the video, aka how many frames I get in a second of the video, totaling 1,194,392,832 bits, or approximately 149.3 megabytes per second. This may sound like a lot, but it would pretty much be a one-to-one with the amount of data stored. So a file of 149.3 megabytes would take a 1 second video. All sounds good in theory, but soon the problem started to arise. Surprisingly, the size was never one, quite the opposite. For example, using the B-movie script as a testing file, the entirety of it was filling about 1% of a frame, and you can't really upload a one-frame video to YouTube. Don't worry, I tested it. So I figured I'd add some padding of pure black, all bytes on zero, at the start and end of the video, because for some reason YouTube cuts off the last couple of frames, something that had to be addressed in all solutions called YouTube, hoping the YouTube compression will deal with those. Well, it did. And did more than that, as that pretty much put the last nail in the coffin for this solution. Firstly, what is compression in videos? Well, to put it simply, it's an algorithm that compares subsequent frames in a video and only counts for the differences, instead of the entire frames, discarding what is identical or incredibly close to that, resulting in considerably lower file sizes without making it visible to a normal viewer for most videos. Well, the problem here is that I can't afford even the tiniest bit of compression on the data frames, and no matter what I tried, it seems the YouTube compression algorithm, plural actually, as I've read there are multiple and nobody knows the manner in which they are chosen, so I couldn't even reverse engineer that, did not allow this solution to be viable. I have to say, this idea took quite a while to come up with and implement, and could only realize it couldn't be used only after fully completing it. So you may imagine I was pretty distraught, thinking I may actually have to drop the entire project, as at the time I couldn't come up with another solution. So I decided to put it on hold and move on to researching some other stuff. Some silly thing about QR codes and how big or small you could make them without affecting the stored data, and wait a minute. Apparently, QR codes aren't really affected by scaling them up or down, of course to some limits, but they are pretty lenient, as long as the data modules are identifiable. Of course, this comes with a disadvantage of the fact that the QR code can only hold 2,953 bytes of data. Quite a significant drop from 6.22 megabytes per frame, but it meant that YouTube could apply whatever compression they wanted and it wouldn't matter at all. And ultimately, with the compression stuff, the file sizes wouldn't end up quite that big anyway. And with that, I simply had to read the data in the same manner, but with a much smaller block size, create a QR code from that and append it as a frame. I also added some validation with a simple checksum and some metadata in a JSON converted into a QR code and appended that as a frame, to verify the integrity of the decoded data, and I finished it off by putting an empty QR code as the final frame. Again, thank you YouTube. And now it's done! You can literally use this as you would any remote cloud storage CLI and should, I hope, work as intended. Of course, it's not without fault. First, if your YouTube account is new, you can only upload 10 videos per day. But that can be easily increased if you do some of those checks for your channel. Also, depending on your internet speed, it may be quite slow, maybe even end up having to modify a variable to allow for longer loading times. But to be fair, if your internet is slow, it's gonna be slow anywhere. Finally, I could have added some encryption to the data before conversion, as the videos are stored as unlisted to be able to download them. But I considered it to be outside the scope of this project. But all in all, I'm happy I managed to complete this project, and I hope you also enjoyed this. And if you did, you know the drill.